Mr. Young, for whom we were waiting, at length came aboard, followed by a little black dog that immediately made himself at home by curling up in a hollow among the baggage. I like dogs, but this one seemed so small, dull, and worthless that I objected to his going and asked the missionary why he was taking him. Such a helpless wisp of hair will only be in the way, I said. Pass him up to one of the Indian boys on the wharf to be taken home to play with his children. This trip is not likely to be a good one for toy dogs. Swim like a seal, and was wondrous flies, etc. Making out a list of virtues likely to make him the most interesting of the company. Of his ancestry. He was short-legged, bunchy-bodied, and almost featureless, something like a muskrat. Though smooth, his hair was long and silky. so that when the wind was at his back, it ruffled, making him look shaggy. Dog was about the size of a wood rat. He was presented to his wife by an Irish prospector at Sitka. Invincibly quiet and doing many inexplicable things that piqued my curiosity. But he never asked help, made any complaint. As if, like a philosopher, he had learned that without hard work and suffering, there could be no pleasure worth having. No super annuitant mastiff or bulldog grown old in office surpassed this soft midget in stoic dignity. After we had explored the glaciers of the Sumdum and Taku inlets, we sailed through Stevens Passage into Lynn Canal. While the tide was in our favor and crossed sound, we were accompanied by a fleet of icebergs drifting out to the ocean from Glacier Bay. On first observation, the glacier presented some unusual features, and that night I planned a great excursion for tomorrow. For in storms, nature has always something extra fine to show us. So I took my ice axe, buttoned my coat, put a piece of bread in my pocket, and set out. But I had not gone a dozen rods before he left his warm bed in the tent and came boring through the blast after me. The dog just stood there in the wind, drenched, blinking, saying doggedly, "Where thou goest, I will go." So I told him to come on if he must, gave him a piece of the bread I had put in my pocket for breakfast. Then we pushed on in company. Thus began the most memorable of all my wild days. The level flood, driving straight in our faces, thrashed and washed us wildly until we got into the shelter of the trees and ice cliffs on the east side of the glacier. The exploration of the glacier was my main object. When the wind began to abate, I traced the east side of the glacier. Beneath the gray sky, a seemingly boundless prairie of ice. Getting caught in a tangle of crevasses. And perhaps 1,000 feet deep, beautiful and awful. Thank you. Any crevasse that I could jump, he would leap without so much as halting to examine. Then I began to feel anxiety as to finding a way in the storm through the intricate network of crevasses which we had entered. The snow warned us to make haste, but at the same time hid our way. Many a mile we thus traveled, mostly up and down, making but little real headway in crossing, most of the time running instead of walking, as the danger of spending the night on the glacier became threatening. Now, a cautious mountaineer seldom takes a step on unknown ground, which seems at all dangerous, that he cannot retrace in case he should be stopped by unseen obstacles. Should I risk this dangerous jump, or try to regain the woods on the west shore, make a fire, and have only hunger to endure while waiting for a new day? Crossed so broad a tangle of dangerous ice that I saw it would be difficult to get back to the woods through the storm. While the ice just beyond the present barrier seemed more promising, and the east shore was now perhaps about as near as the west. I was therefore eager to go on, but this wide jump was a tremendous obstacle. At length, because of the dangers already behind me, I determined to venture against those that might be ahead, jumped, and landed well, but with so little to spare that I more than ever dreaded being compelled to take that jump back from the lower side. We were on an island about 2 miles long and from 100 to 300 yards wide. Barely possible ways of escape. Of the many perils encountered in my years of wandering in mountain altitudes, none seemed so plain and stern and merciless as this. He came behind me, pushed his head past my shoulder, looked down and across, scanned the sliver and its approaches with his queer eyes, then looked me in the face with a startled air of surprise and concern, and began to mutter and whine, saying as plainly as if speaking with words, "Surely you're not going to try that awful place." Went back to the woods, the wolves would kill him. And at last, with the courage of despair, hushed and breathless, he lay down on the brink. Hollow I had made for my knees, pressed his body against the ice to get the advantage of the friction, gazed into the first step, put his little feet together, and slid them slowly down into it. Then, without lifting them as well as I could see through the snow, he slowly worked them over the edge of the step, and down into the next in succession, in the same way. Gained the bridge. Then lifting his feet with the regularity and slowness of the vibrations of a second's pendulum, as if counting and measuring, 1, 2, 3, in dainty pose and giving separate attention to each little step, he gained the foot of the cliff at the top of which I was kneeling to give him a lift should he get within reach. Then suddenly up he came with a nervy, springy rush, hooking his paws into the notches and stepped so quickly that I could not see how it was done, and whizzed past my head, safe at last. Invincibly quiet and doing many inexplicable things that piqued my curiosity. On closer inspection, you might see his thin, sensitive ears and his keen, dark eyes with cunning tan spots. The dog was about the size of a wood rat. After we had explored the glaciers of the Sum Dum and Taku Inlets, we sailed through Stephen's Passage into Lynn Canal. Eager to go on, but this wide jump was a tremendous obstacle. At length, because of the dangers already behind me, I determined to venture against those that might be ahead, jumped, and landed well, but with so little to spare that I more than ever dreaded being compelled to take that jump back from the lower side. No super annuitant mastiff or bulldog grown old in office surpassed this soft midget in stoic dignity. Slippery surface, get astride of it. I warned him that if he went back to the woods, the wolves would kill him. So I took my ice axe, buttoned my coat, put a piece of bread in my pocket, and set out. The level flood, driving straight in our faces, thrashed and washed us wildly until we got into the shelter of the trees and ice cliffs on the east side of the glacier. While the tide was in our favor and crossed sound, we were accompanied by a fleet of icebergs drifting out to the ocean from Glacier Bay. However, in storms, nature has always something extra fine to show us. Any crevasse that I could jump, he would leap without so much as halting to examine it. After we had explored the glaciers of the Sum Dum and Taku Inlets, we sailed through Stevens Passage into Lynn Canal. I feared getting caught in a tangle of crevasses. Though smooth, his hair was long and silky. So I took my ice axe, buttoned my coat, put a piece of bread in my pocket, and set out. To make haste, but at the same time hit our own way. Never before had I been so long under deadly strain. How I got up the cliff at the end of the bridge, I never could tell. I feared getting caught in a tangle of crevasses. So I told him to come on if he must, and gave him a piece of the bread I had put in my pocket for breakfast. On closer inspection, you might see his thin, sensitive ears and his keen, dark eyes with cunning tan spots. Then suddenly up he came with a nervy, springy rush, hooking his paws into the notches and stepped so quickly that I could not see how it was done, and whizzed past my head, safe at last. Then lifting his feet with the regularity and slowness of the vibrations of a second's pendulum, as if counting and measuring, one, two, three. Any crevasse that I could jump, he would leap without so much as halting to examine. Against the ice to get the advantage of the friction, gazed into the first step, put his little feet together, and slid them slowly down into the floor. Never before had I been so long under deadly strain. How I got up the cliff at the end of the bridge, I never could tell. Nature is always something extra fine to show us. Thank you. convincingly quiet and doing many inexplicable things that piqued my curiosity. Many a mile we thus traveled, mostly up and down, making but little real headway across it, most of the time running instead of walking, as the danger of spending the night on the glacier became threatening. The snow warned us to make haste, but at the same time hid our way.
Thank you.
but he never asked help or made any complaint, as if, like a philosopher, he had learned that without hard work and suffering, there could be no pleasure worth having. So smooth, his hair was long and silky. But I had not gone a dozen rods before he left his warm bed in the tent and came boring through the blast after me. while the ice just beyond the present barrier seemed more promising, and the east shore was now perhaps about as near as the west. Invincibly quiet and doing many inexplicable things that piqued my curiosity. Thank you. were on an island about 2 miles long and from 100 to 300 yards wide. Two barely possible ways of escape.
Thank you.
On first observation, the glacier presented some unusual features, and that night I planned a great excursion for the park. So that when the wind was at his back, it ruffled, making him look shaggy. Mr. Young, for whom we were waiting, at length came aboard, followed by a little black dog that immediately made himself at home by curling up in a hollow among the baggage. I like dogs, but this one seemed so small, dull, and worthless that I objected to his going and asked the missionary why he was taking him. such a helpless wisp of hair will only be in the way, I said. Better pass him up to one of the Indian boys on the wharf to be taken home to play with his children. This trip is not likely to be a good one for toy dogs. Missionary assured me that he would be no trouble at all, that he was a perfect wonder of a dog. Could endure cold and hunger like a polar bear. Like a seal, and was wondrous wise, etc. Making out a list of virtues likely to make him the most interesting of the company. Nobody could hope to unravel the lines of his ancestry. He was short-legged, bunchy-bodied, and almost featureless, something like a muskrat. Though smooth, his hair was long and silky. So that when the wind was at his back, it ruffled, making him look shaggy. Noticeable feature was his showy tail, which was about as shady and airy as a squirrel's. and was carried curling forward nearly to his ears. Closer inspection, you might see his thin, sensitive ears and his keen, dark eyes with cunning tan spots. Mr. Young told me that when the dog was about the size of a wood rat, to his wife by an Irish prospector at Sitka. On our trip, he soon proved himself a queer character. Keeping invincibly quiet and doing many inexplicable things that piqued my curiosity. But he never asked help or made any complaint. As if, like a philosopher, he had learned that without hard work and suffering, there could be no pleasure worth having. No super annuited mastiff or bulldog grown old in office surpassed this soft midget in stoic dignity. After we had explored the glaciers of the Sumdum and Taku Inlets, we sailed through Stevens Passage into Lynn Canal. While the tide was in our favor and crossed sound, we were accompanied by a fleet of icebergs drifting out to the ocean from Glacier Bay. On first observation, the glacier presented some unusual features, and that night I planned a great excursion for tomorrow. For in storms, nature has always something extra fine to show us. So I took my ice axe, buttoned my coat, put a piece of bread in my pocket, and set out. Gone a dozen rods before he left his warm bed in the tent and came boring through the blast after me. The dog just stood there in the wind, drenched and blinking, saying doggedly, "Where thou goest, I will go." I told him to come on if he must, and gave him a piece of the bread I had put in my pocket for breakfast. Then we pushed on in company. Thus began the most memorable of all my wild days. Flood, driving straight in our faces, thrashed and washed us wildly until we got into the shelter of the trees and ice cliffs on the east side of the glacier. The exploration of the glacier was my main object. When the wind began to abate, I traced the east side of the glacier. Beneath the gray sky, a seemingly boundless prairie of ice. I feared getting caught in a tangle of crevasses. And perhaps 1,000 feet deep, beautiful and awful. Any crevasse that I could jump, he would leap without so much as halting to examine it. Then I began to feel anxiety as to finding a way in the storm through the intricate network of crevasses which we had entered. This is what snow warned us to make haste, but at the same time, hit our way. Many a mile we thus traveled, mostly up and down, making but little real headway across it, most of the time running instead of walking, as the danger of spending the night on the glacier became threatening. Now, a cautious mountaineer seldom takes a step on unknown ground which seems at all dangerous, that he cannot retrace in case he should be stopped by unseen obstacles ahead. Should I risk this dangerous jump? Or try to regain the woods on the west shore, make a fire, and have only hunger to endure while waiting for a new day? I had already crossed so broad a tangle of dangerous ice that I saw it would be difficult to get back to the woods through the storm. Just beyond the present barrier seemed more promising, and the east shore was now perhaps about as near as the west. I was therefore eager to go on, but this wide jump was a tremendous obstacle. At length, because of the dangers already behind me, I determined to venture against those that might be ahead, jumped, and landed well, but with so little to spare that I more than ever dreaded being compelled to take that jump back from the lower side. We were on an island about 2 miles long and from 100 to 300 yards wide, with two barely possible ways of escape. Many perils encountered in my years of wandering in mountain altitudes, none seemed so plain and stern and merciless as this. After the end of the bridge was reached, it was a delicate thing to poise on a little platform which I had chipped on its upcurving end, bending over the slippery surface to get astride of it. Never before had I been so long under deadly strain. How I got up the cliff at the end of the bridge, I never could tell. Pushed his head past my shoulder, looked down and across, scanned the sliver and its approaches with his queer eyes, then looked me in the face with a startled air of surprise and concern, and began to mutter and whine, saying as plainly as if speaking with words, "Surely you're not going to try that awful place." The danger was enough to daunt anybody, but it seemed wonderful that he should have been able to weigh and appreciate it so justly. Thank you. No mountaineer could have seen it more quickly or judged it more wisely, discriminating between real and apparent peril. After I had gained the other side, he howled louder than ever. And at last, with the courage of despair, hushed and breathless, he lay down on the brink in the hollow I had made for my knees, pressed his body against the ice to get the advantage of the friction, gazed into the first step, put his little feet together, and slid them slowly down into it. Then, without lifting him as well as I could see through the snow, he slowly worked them over the edge of the step and down into the next in succession in the same way, and gained the bridge. Then, lifting his feet with the regularity and slowness of the vibrations of a second's pendulum, as if counting and measuring, one, two, three. Holding himself in dainty pose and giving separate attention to each little step, he gained the foot of the cliff at the top of which I was kneeling to give him a lift should he get within reach. Then suddenly up he came with a nervy, springy rush, hooking his paws into the notches and stepped so quickly that I could not see how it was done, and whizzed past my head, safe at last. Making out a list of virtues likely to make him the most interesting of the company. Thank you. first sight, his only noticeable feature was his showy tail, which was about as shady and airy as a squirrel's. Was about the size of a wood rat. Beneath the gray sky, a seemingly boundless prairie of ice. Never asked help, made any complaint, as if like a philosopher he had learned that without hard work and suffering there would be no pleasure worth having. He came behind me, pushed his head past my shoulder, looked down and across, scanned the sliver and its approaches with his queer eyes, then looked me in the face with a startled air of surprise and concern, and began to mutter or whine, saying as plainly as if speaking with words, "Surely you're not going to try that awful place." He was presented to his wife by an Irish prospector at Sitka. Beneath the gray sky, a seemingly boundless prairie of ice.